Good morning, Center Church. How's everyone doing today? Come on, let's stand to our feet and worship the Lord this morning. Let's see those hands up. Come on, we sing together.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am saved with you.
Come on, saints, let's declare that this morning. We sing.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
Come on, let's continue to sing.
When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Cross, God, you see the empty tomb.
Hallelujah. Come on, saints.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the
power of our God. Come on, say, lift your voice this morning. We say,
an almighty fortress, you go before us.
Yes,
nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Almighty, almighty
fortress, you go before us.
Yes, you.
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. The battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh, 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 oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Yes, it does. Come on, saints, lift up a shout of praise in this house. Hallelujah. Amen. Who's excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Anyone excited? If you were here last week, we were on Zoom, so it's so awesome to see you in 2024 in person. Amen. So there's so much to celebrate, so much to be grateful about, and so much to thank God for. So before we continue in worship, I know I ask this a lot, you beating a dead horse every single Sunday, but there's something special and significant about when you come into the house of the Lord and you center your mind, no pun intended, but you center your focus, you center who you are, your week, anything that you've gone through, and you center it back on the Lord. And there's something significant because it's important to say, God, you're bigger than the circumstance. You're bigger than the obstacle. You're bigger than the assignments. You're bigger than the work, the bills, everything. God, you are the most important thing. So for 10, 15 minutes, I'm going to pour out praise that's undistracted, solely focused on you. So church, would you, if you're comfortable, lift your hands as a sign of surrender. And would you just invite him into this space? Would you just say, God, have your way in my life, in the life of my kids, in the life of my family. And God, would you meet with us today? There's a story where Jacob, he has a dream and he sees this ladder going up to heaven. And then he wakes up from that dream. And in that dream, well, he sees angels going up and down, descending from heaven on earth. And then he wakes up and he goes, surely I missed God in this place. And church, I would hate to be a church that meets on a Sunday morning and we have that moment like Jacob and we say, surely I was asleep and I did not know that the Lord was here or I missed him. So God, we give you all of our attention, all of our focus, and we just pour out our praise before you, Lord. And if we have nothing else to say, Lord, we just say thank you. Thank you for this space. Thank you for community, Lord God. Thank you for the gathering of the saints this morning, Lord. Have your way in our services today, Lord God. And Holy Spirit, would you just come and fill the room? Fill our hearts, fill our minds, Lord. Fill the room, fill the room. Have your way in us today, Lord. Have your way, Jesus. We invite you, Lord. And as the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on. Come on, you sing. As the Spirit was moving over the water, come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. So come. Spirit, when you move, you made my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're hearing, I know you are moving. I'm hearing, I know you will fill me, calm down. Spirit, when you move, you made my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're hearing, I know you are moving. I'm hearing, I know you will fill me. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. We say, come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come on, full of faith, we declare fire and wind. So fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on fire. So fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. So calm down. Spirit, when you move, you made my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're hearing, I know you are moving. I'm hearing, I know you will fill me. Calm down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're hearing, I know you are moving. I'm hearing, I know you will fill me. Oh, fill me. Fill our hearts. you made my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're hearing.
I knew you were moving.
Yeah.
I'm hearing. I knew you would fill me.
So calm down, Spirit. When you move, you made my heart pound. When you fill the room. Church, lift your voices in this space this morning. Fall afresh on us, Lord.
With your heart and lead me in your love. to those around me. Lead me in your love. Jesus, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, Jesus, the only one who could ever see. Worthy of every breath we could ever be. We live for you. We live for you. Oh.
Open up my
sing that one more time. Holy, holy, there is no one like you. There is none besides. Sing it out. Open up my eyes and show me who you are and fill me with your heart. And you look to those Jesus' name is above every other name. His name is above every circumstance, every battle that we face. He's worthy of our praise this morning. Amen. We're going to pray together in just a moment, and I would invite you just to stay standing for this time. This weekend, our country, and tomorrow specifically, will celebrate the life of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., a civic rights activist and minister in the 50s and 60s, leading a nonviolent movement that ended legal segregation and pushed for civil rights for all people. Undoubtedly, his life work will stand as a strong pillar of our country's history and a constant reminder of how far we must go. Today, before we pray his words, I'm going to read a tribute that are his words. It'll be on the screen for you to read. He says, I decided early to give my life to something eternal and absolute, not to these little, small g gods that are here today and gone tomorrow, but to God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear. Let no man pull you so low as to hate him. Forgiveness is not an occasional act. It is a permanent attitude. Life's most persistent and urgent question is, what will you do for others? Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. For the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. Today and every day, Center Church will honor Martin Luther King Jr.'s life work and will stand committed to an ongoing pursuit of unity and equality. I would invite you to pray this prayer together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your church, founded upon your word, that challenges us to do more than sing and pray, but go out and work as though the very answer to our prayers depended on us and not upon you. Help us to realize that humanity was created to shine like the stars and live on through all eternity. Keep us, we pray, in perfect peace. Help us to walk together, pray together, sing together, and live together until that day when all God's children, black, white, red, brown, and yellow, will rejoice in one common band of humanity. In the reign of our Lord and of our God, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Lord Jesus, let it be true of us individually today, and let that be true of Center Church, O God. Father, would everybody who sees Center Church see you? Would everybody who sees Center Church see gospel living, not perfect, but committed to one another and to the growth and to the safety and to the care and to the love of one another? Father, we thank you that this is your church and you will be the one to build it, oh God. What an honor it is to serve you today and every day. We love you in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen and amen. Go ahead, you can clap for the Lord.
And go ahead and take your seats. Want to welcome you to Center Church. Those who are with us in person, I see guests, and we are always so happy to have guests. Those who are worshiping online, good morning. My name is Casey Perez. I'm on staff here. My husband is the pastor, and I just do a few things around here, sometimes helping him, assisting a little bit. But I want to welcome you to Center Church. So glad that you're here. A couple quick announcements this Wednesday. Everybody say Wednesday. We are so excited to partner with Immigrant Connection. This is something that we've been talking about for a long time, and the day is finally here. Some of us met with Immigrant Connection months ago. Some of us are continuing to serve. But ultimately, what we have is we have an incredible opportunity from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. here in the building to provide high-quality, low-cost, legal immigration consultations. Say that 10 times fast. If you or your family or your friends or your coworkers or your neighbors or anybody that you know could benefit from an initial consultation, these are usually hundreds of dollars with an attorney through the connection with Immigrant Connection. We're able to offer it for $25. It is a safe place. We ask one thing. We need pre-registration. In order to do that, you need to either email me, or you can see us after service, me or Pastor Eliezer, or you can call the church, but we need to pre-register you. So that's when? Wednesday, January 17th. And Center Church, there's always opportunities to serve. There's always opportunities to love. So if you'd like to come and partner and be here, please come and talk to me, because there'll be plenty to do that day. The men. Hi, good morning. Mark, is Phil here? Phil's not here. I needed Phil here, but they have changed their gathering schedule. So moving forward, they'll be meeting once monthly for breakfast, and then one Thursday a month they'll be meeting for a gathering where they encourage and read scriptures. That time this month is January 25th at 7 p.m. Location is still to be determined. Maybe Phil's place, maybe somewhere else, but guys, go ahead and mark your calendars for that. And then finally, everyone say January 28th. We invite you to our first community meal of 2024. If you are new to Center Church, it's just a really great time. We just eat a lot of food, and we laugh a lot, and we spend time together, and it's wonderful. So no pre-registration needed for that. You just need to bring a dish that you can share with everybody. It'll be right after service. And prepare to do one of three things. Either come early to set up, be available to serve during the meal, or stay after to clean up, and that will help all around. Sound good? As always, Center Church, just want to thank you so much for bringing the Lord's tithes and your offerings, whether here in person in the back or through our website. We thank you for that. Kids, I'm going to invite you to stand. We have a special day together, as always. Kids, and you know what? Everybody can stand. Congregation, go ahead. We're going to pray for our kids, dismiss them, and then you can take a few minutes to greet one another. Father, thank you for our children. From our youngest to the oldest, we love them. You love them, more importantly. We ask that you would bless them and keep them. Bless the teachers and the workers and the volunteers. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, kids, you are free to go. And adults, you are free to mingle. Go say hi to somebody. Someone you don't know.
2024, huh? Crazy. Anybody happy for a new year? New opportunities, fresh starts? I dig it. I'll take it. My name is Pastor Eliezer Perez, and I'm so thankful to be here with you today. I'm excited to start into a series that we're going to be talking about something really, really important. We're going to talk about your money. Not my money. I ain't got much. I know you're probably looking at my sneakers up here. They're reps, believe me. $30. All right? Don't worry. But we're going to talk about money because the Bible has a lot to say about money. And one of the most uncomfortable things to talk about in church is money, because so many people feel like when I go to church, all we're going to ever talk about is money, and all the church ever wants is your money. Well, here at Center, you know that we don't ask you for money. We don't pass around offering buckets. It is up to you to give as generously as you would like. We teach biblical ethics on giving. We teach tithing. We teach how to give generously, how to have a generous heart. And that's what this series is really going to be all about. But ultimately, your money is yours. You could do with it what you want. But we want to give a biblical background to how we should view money in a way that honors God. How many say amen to that? So nothing impacts your relationship with God. This has to be the foundation to everything. Nothing has the potential to impact your relationship with God like money does. In fact, all of your relationships are impacted by your outlook on money. Financial reasons is one of the leading reasons cited for divorce. Can you believe that? Well, of course, because always seems like there's never enough. When you have two different people coming with two different backgrounds, with two different understandings of money and how to spend it, rarely are they going to see eye to eye. And it's such a pitfall, such a troubling way to start a marriage or start a relationship when views of money and how to spend it are completely different. But of course they're going to be different. Last year, one-third of responders in a Credit Karma study said that they had ended a relationship over disagreements about money. More than 40% say that they fight about finances on a monthly basis. Thank God Casey and I aren't a part of that 40%, because we fight about it weekly. Just kidding. Your view on money will absolutely affect your relationships with your friends, with your family, with your closest associates and loved ones. So first we have to ask, where is it that we learn what we learn about money? And you don't have to think far. You don't have to look very hard to see that your parents are probably the greatest influence over your ideas about money. I remember when I was graduating from college, and my dad came up to visit from Puerto Rico. He came to celebrate my graduation. And, you know, I had saved up some money because I always worked. That was one thing I learned from the time I was really young. Always have a job, never depend on other people for money. And so by the time I was graduating, you know, going out with Casey hadn't completely dried me up of all my funds, praise God. I put a little bit to the side. And then at our graduation party, you know, we had a lot of people, and people were very kind and very generous. So by the end of it, you know, I was like, cha-ching, you know, rolling in the dough a little bit, had a few $1,000s. I was feeling myself, and I was like, ooh, I'm about to go buy me a new car. I can't wait. And I was hanging out with my dad, and we were looking at cars, and there was, you know, we were at a Toyota dealership, and he was like, oh, that one's nice. You should get that one. And I'm looking at it like, God, that's so much money. There's no way that I can afford that, you know. And his advice is something that stayed with me, because it wasn't just something that he said then. It was something that I saw in him growing up. And that was, you have it now. You have the money right now. You might not have it in the future, so spend it while you have it. Anybody else learn that lesson growing up? Hey, if you got the money, spend it. And that was really instrumental into how I viewed money as a child growing up and into my marriage and young adult through the young adult years. My mother, on the other hand, she used to sell cars for a living. So in that same instance, you know, she didn't care what the price was. All she cared about was me not getting ripped off. All she cared was that I got a good deal, right? So if you get a good deal, then spend the money if you have it. And that was the other part of my kind of ideas about money. And so literally growing up into my adult years, my thoughts on money were never pay retail. That's why I wear reps. And if you got it, spend it. If you don't have it, you don't spend it. But there weren't many thoughts about what to do in the future. There wasn't many ideas of, you know, how to save, how to put away, how to invest, anything like that. All I learned was, if you have it, spend it, but only if you can get a good deal. What about you? What are some of the things, and this is rhetorical, obviously, but how did you learn about money? What did you learn about money? Who were those influences over your life about money? An article out of the University of Minnesota said that up until the time children leave for college or otherwise move out of the house, they pick up cues from how their parents talked about money and budgeting. That's what we were just talking about. But they called it a process called financial socialization. So like in the same way that you're socialized in relationships and how to connect with people, in the same way, you have a socialization of your finances. What's interesting that they said next is that second to your parents, the next greatest influence on money and how you spend money, how you view money, is your romantic partners. So young adults, pay attention, and I'm seeing all of the young couples nudging each other. I hope you could all make it today. But we have a plethora, we'll call it, of young married couples married within the last few years, and they're all like, "Oh yeah, this is talking about us right now." I know, I see it in your face. It's hilarious. So when you're in these young adult years, it's very important that you consider what you think about money, where your influences about money come, because soon in your life, you'll be sharing that with somebody very close to you, and that person will be influencing you, and you will be influencing them. So your parents influence your financial decision-making, your love interests have a lot to say in how you spend money and what you think about money, but the question is, what does God have to say about our finances? Does God care? Does it matter to him? And where, if it does his ideas about money actually have a place in your life? Right? More importantly than your parents and your love interests, if God has something to say about it, then shouldn't we value what he has to say more than anybody else? Well, I believe I'm looking at people who want to please God, who want to love God with all their heart, soul, and strength. And if that's the case, then we need to look no further than what God thinks about your money. So yes, God cares about your money. In fact, he has a lot to say about it. In the book of Luke, which we're going to be looking at, the gospel, you cannot read a chapter without finding something that relates back to money. And again, it isn't because God needs your money. It isn't because God wants your money. But in all reality, it's because money has the ability to be the biggest competition for God of your heart. And therefore, how you think and view and act and spend money is very important to God. I know what you're thinking, Pastor. You just want to talk to us about tithing. The church has some needs. We need to, you know, do this and that. And so that's why we're doing this. It's like, sorry to disappoint you. My desire is for you to grow in Christ, to reflect Jesus as best as you can. You can do with your money what you want. But for me, what I want for you is to see you grow in the Lord. And when there is anything that the Bible has to say something about that competes with God, that seems like something pretty important that we need to address. So let's be honest, I don't care. The needs of this church belong to God because this is his house, not mine. And guess what? He's been really good to us. He's always met our needs. So I have no worries about that. I have no fear and I have no reason to coerce or manipulate in any way, shape, or form. This is about us as people. How many say amen? So it turns out that your money actually matters to God. It really actually does. And you might ask, why? Why would God care about my money? Again, because nothing affects your relationship with God like your view of money. On the negative side, right, on the worst case scenario, on the negative side, money can start as just an obstacle and grow all the way to being an idol. That's on the bad side. At worst, it could be, I mean, at start, at a minimum, it's an obstacle. An obstacle that keeps you from really being able to follow God the way that he would like you to. But at worst, it's an idol that keeps you away from God completely. That's the negative side. On the positive side, money can say a lot about your strong dependence on God. So the way that you view and spend and use money actually can say something good about how you trust and depend in the Lord. But then all the way to the extreme of the best possible scenario, money can be used as a tool for God's purposes. So you can actually partner with God on what he wants to do when you view money the way that God would want you to. So at the worst, it's an idol. And at the best, it's this wonderful tool that causes you to work hand in hand with God. So it's extremely important. And I think that especially in the time and the day and age that we're living in, it's so important that we centralize God's view of money in our lives. I mean, think about the scenario. Think about the cultural context that we're in right now. Inflation is as high as it's ever been in my lifetime. The cost of housing is multiplied. I remember when Casey and I first got married in 2005 and we were able to buy our first house, and we thought our house was expensive at $250,000. That same house today is worth $600,000. More than double the cost in just 18 short years that we've been married. The cost of groceries, you feel like you can't walk through the grocery store without your pockets deflating. It's just like, it's like your pants get tighter and tighter as you walk through the aisles. You spend more and you walk away with less. The cost of insurances, whether for vehicle, for house, for health, everything. Education is for sale now. Feels like education is nothing more than a product that you go and buy nowadays. Less and less is education about actually training and growing you to be something or to do something. Now it's just a product that you're picking off of a shelf and you're like, oh yeah, this is a nice name. This is a good name brand and that's great. $100,000, I'll take that with me. Thank you very much. Everything is so expensive in the world that we live in today. And so because of that, it's more important that we centralize God's view of money and marginalize the world's view of money. Push that to the side and allow God's ways to be what leads us. To do that today, to provide somewhat of a foundation, we're going to look at two narratives in the Gospel of Luke. One is in Luke chapter 18, and the other is in Luke 19. And what we're doing is contrasting two different people and how they responded to Jesus when he approached them about their money. The first one is in Luke chapter 18. We're going to start in verse 18. It'll be up there unless you have your Bible. That's great. It says this: a certain ruler asked him, Jesus that is, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. You know the commandments? You shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, honor your father and mother. The man says, all these I have kept since I was a boy. So he's probably feeling himself, right? Probably thinking, oh, this is looking good for me. Verse 22, when Jesus heard this, he said to him, you lack one thing. Sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. Verse 23, when he heard this, he became very sad because he was very wealthy. Let's talk about this young man for a second. Bible tells us he's a young ruler and he's rich. Not a bad combination, right? All the ladies are like, hey, that's my man right there. I'll take, yes, please. Sign me up. Yeah, he's young, he's rich, and he's pretty good, right? I mean, look at how he approaches Jesus. He approaches Jesus, he calls him good teacher. And this is so interesting, right? Because internally, all of us have these meters that are going off. Every time we meet somebody, we have this internal scale that we base to judge other people. And this man clearly saw Jesus, and whatever his internal scale said, he thought to himself, Jesus is a good man. So he calls him, hey, good teacher. And Jesus is like, you must be recognizing me as God because nobody is good except for God. He's so, you know, his internal scales says to him, Jesus, he's a good guy. And I want to be a good guy. So how can I be like Jesus? Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? In other words, how can I be like you? So this guy is rich, he's young, and he wants to be good. Yeah, it's pretty attractive. But Jesus puts his finger on the one thing that the man places his entire identity on. He says, you know the commandments? Oh, yeah, I never kill anybody. I've been good to my parents. I'm feeling pretty good. So his internal meter about himself is starting to, you know, it's starting to light up. It's going from yellow to green, and, you know, he's feeling really good. He's like, yeah, all right, I'm on my way. But Jesus, as he often does, he says, okay, that's great. Let's talk about what really matters. And he puts his finger on the man's money. He said, go sell everything you have. Give it to the poor. Like, what? What are you talking about? Is that even a thing? Like, why would I have to do that to inherit eternal life? Well, because you're trying to justify yourself. You're trying to make yourself good enough to enter heaven, and that's just never going to happen. And because he knows it's not going to happen that way, he asks him of something that is equally impossible. He says, go sell everything. Is it interesting? Is Jesus' interest that we sell everything that we have and give it to the poor? No. But in that moment, he knew that to that man whose identity was wrapped up in his stuff, the most important thing keeping him away from God was his money. So he says, go get rid of it. And then come and follow me. So he recognizes that there was this huge stumbling block, not just a stumbling block, but like a wall between him and God that would never allow him to be a follower of Jesus. So he says, get rid of it. And the man goes away sad. You know what? I can't blame him. I mean, how many of us right now, if we really were honest about where money is in our hearts, and Jesus comes along and says, I want you to sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and then come follow me, we would all be like this man. There may be one, like, truly altruistic person in this space right now. And you are better than all of us. If you're just like, I will do it, God bless you, we need to be more like you. No, we need to be more like Jesus. But the fact is, almost all of us would almost immediately turn and walk away just like this man and be very sad, thinking, oh, we can't do it. So a couple of things to talk about here is, how money affects our identity. Identity, you understand, is a very dangerous thing. I mean, part of the reason why culturally we're in such a battle is because of the value of identity. There is almost nothing that we won't do in order to fit into a certain identity. And we often place those identities above every other priority in our lives. And nowadays, in the culture that we live in, it says you have to figure out a different way to be, you know, you have to be the same as everybody, but set apart a different way. So everybody's being like extreme versions of the same person, finding different ways to be exactly like everybody else. And then you tell them, well, you know, your identity really isn't that valuable, and they flip out. Everybody goes crazy. Even now, as I'm saying this, it's grating against you because the reality is that God has an identity for you that is not the one that the world has placed on you. And no matter what you put your identity in, whether it be money or some other cultural value, at the end of the day, it will fail you. The one identity that you and I can always guarantee to be safe for us, to guarantee to be completely found as a whole human being, the only way is to be a child of God. The only way is to put our entire identity in who he says that we are and not who we think we could be. In this case, for this man, money was his identity and it kept him from being able to follow Jesus. So I ask you, what do you think your identity could be that is so important that Jesus would just be like, oh yeah, I'm cool with that? Other than him being at the center. There is no other identity but being found as a child of God, because when you are found as a child of God, he says, you are enough. You are my son. You are my daughter. And every parent in here knows exactly what I'm talking about. If you are a parent, then you already know, because your child doesn't have to do or act a certain way to receive your love. They have it because they are yours. Well, the God of creation says, you don't need something else to define you. You don't need your money, how much or how little you have, to be something that places value on you. You are mine. I will always love you. I will always have your back until you turn your back on me, walk away in order to pursue this other identity. So whatever your identities are, whatever we search for, all of it will ultimately fail us. But as we maintain the right identity as children of God, then he could be at the forefront. He could be at the center. And then there's nothing to stumble us or to keep us from following him. This man was unwilling to release the grip that money had on his identity. And just as Jesus does often, he puts his finger on it. And as a result, a man has to walk away sad, unfulfilled, thirsting for real definition. Look at what Matthew 6:24 says. We're going to veer out of Luke for a moment. But it says, no one can serve two masters. This is exactly what Jesus was pointing the finger at in this man. He had his finger on this one particular nerve. He said, you will either hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. And then he makes it so clear, you cannot serve both God and money. I mean, it doesn't get any more clear than this. Money can be it is so easily the one thing that could trip us up from being able to follow Jesus. The one thing that could so easily become a God to us. You can be going to church. You could be putting your kid in kids' church. You could be reading your Bible. You could be, but if the idea of money isn't what God says it should be, then you could be serving money and not God. Because you can't do both. All right. Let's take a look at another interaction that Jesus had and see what a difference the right perspective makes. We're going to go to Luke chapter 19 now. It's just a few verses forward. And of course, the original Bible wasn't written with chapters and verses. So this is just literally in the mind of Luke, the author, and through the Holy Spirit, just a few lessons. There's two lessons between these two men. So it was completely intentional that they're right next to each other. Look what he says. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. And this is so important. I know, like, you know, I get hung up on like the littlest details, you know, but it's so important. Jesus was on his way to Jericho because this was the last thing that Jesus would do before his triumphal entry. So for those of you who don't have a good picture of you know, the New Testament and whatnot, you know, we come to Easter time and we talk about when Jesus came into Jerusalem and everybody's, you know, Hosanna, laying down the palms. We celebrate that, right? We celebrate that because that was like the countdown began in that moment between then and the cross. It was just a few days. And so, or actually, I think 48 hours. And so it kicks off a bunch of events. And in the mind of the gospel writers, right, they're talking about Jesus' birth. They talk about his life, his ministry. But then they flip a page and it's like, all right, let's get down to it. We're going to talk about what this man, everything that was all of this, all of the acts, all of the kindness, all of the lessons, all of the healings were for the sake of him, a good man, being put on the cross to die for the sins of humanity to cover us for eternity. Like that was what everything was about. And so the order of things really matter. And the last thing that the gospel writer puts before the passion begins, before that countdown begins, is this interaction with this man named Zacchaeus. So Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. Right, so doesn't tell us if he's young, doesn't tell if he's handsome, but it says that he was, you know, he was obviously very wealthy. But a tax collector, understand, was not liked. A tax collector was actually loathed. They were despised because they were viewed as traitors. Here you have Jewish people who are working for Rome, which is viewed as the oppressors over the Jewish people. So the Romans hated the Jews. But then even their own Jews hated their own people who were traitors towards them, right? So Zacchaeus was not a popular man. And the fact that he was wealthy when most of Jewish society at that point was completely impoverished, of course they would hate him all the more, right? So this man was wealthy. He wanted to see Jesus. He had an eye out for Jesus. He wanted to see Jesus, but he was short. So he couldn't see over the crowd. So we're introduced to this man as it's like this, like, you know, I love how the Bible does this all the time, like juxtaposing different ideas. So he was wealthy, so he was big, but he was short, and so he was small. And so in order for him to see Jesus, he had this great desire to see Jesus. He had to run ahead, and he had to go climb a tree in order to look down where Jesus was. But that shows intention. That shows actual passion, right? That shows, like, he had that desire, and so he was willing to do whatever he needed to do in order to be put in a position where he could see Jesus, not knowing that the whole time Jesus had his eyes on him. So he ran ahead, climbed the sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Verse 5, when he reached the spot, he looked up. This is talking about Jesus now. He said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. And this is a huge theme in the Gospel of Luke, this idea of hospitality, this idea of God coming to dwell among us. So this is actually a very important picture of the gospel. Again, very important. It's the last thing before the triumphal entry, the last thing before Jesus is about to go be crucified. And we're seeing a picture of what's about to happen on a grand scale. We're seeing it on a very micro scale here. Zacchaeus, spotted by Jesus, he's very small, he's wealthy, so he thinks he has identity, he thinks he has something, and Jesus says to him, I gotta come to you today. It is important. I must stay at your house. So he came down at once, and he welcomed him gladly. That basically means that he brought him to his house. Verse 7, all the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner? See, that was Zacchaeus' identity among the people. That is how he was viewed. That sinner, that guilty person, that person nobody likes, that's who Jesus is hanging out with. All these people saw this. Oh, sorry, I just read that. Verse 8. Listen to this. Zacchaeus doesn't try to justify himself. He doesn't try to measure up to something. This is what he says. Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now, I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay them back four times the amount. He didn't try to justify himself. He didn't say, what do I have to do in order to be right? He just took action. And notice his action was to give half of his possessions. But Jesus asked the other guy for all of it. So that tells you right there that Jesus is not interested in the whether you give everything away or not. That's not what it's about. This man's heart saw and he knew something was wrong in himself when he saw Jesus, and he sought to fix it. And so he made an attempt, and that attempt is called faith. He acted upon faith, not upon requirement. He went and did on his own. The idea of paying back four times for restitution was an Old Testament idea. So he wasn't just trying to measure up. He actually was doing what it took to be right with God according to the Torah, according to the law. And look at what happens. Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. This man was a traitor to his own people. He was hated. He partnered with the oppressors. He most likely, more than likely, was siphoning a little bit off for himself to build his own wealth, taking advantage of everybody else. This is an evil person. This was not a good person. This was not like the rich young ruler who had this internal meter of good and justice that he wanted to fulfill on his own. No, this was a bad man. But the moment he had an interaction with Jesus, a transformation happened. And that thing that was at the center of his heart was removed and replaced. And he didn't just give the lip service. He didn't just give the speech. No, he went into action. Having been with Jesus, he offers up that thing that used to be number one in his life. He no longer wants money to rule him. Yeah. These two people teach us a lot about how money, its pursuit, our ideas of it, the way we spend it, the way we think about it, how it says so much about our relationship with God. As I said before, it could be a stumbling, as small as a little stumbling block that trips you up, or as big as a huge idol that keeps you completely away from God. Or it could be something used to bless God with. We have to ask ourselves, what is money to me? How do I view money? Money matters to God. Your money matters to him, not because he needs it, but because it can easily become an idol. Your identity should never be based on money. How much or how little you have does not determine who you are. And third, God comes close to those who are willing to put him at the center. And that's what God wants for you. That's what God wants for me. Let me tell you, I don't stand up here as somebody who's got it perfectly, you know, all every T dotted, T crossed and I dotted. I have messed up money. We have messed up how we spend it. We have messed up how we view it. Everything you could probably possibly mess up about money, I'm sure that I've done. But at the end of the day, I know one thing is true. It doesn't control me. It doesn't hold me. It doesn't keep me from God. And that's what I hope for every single one of us. Let's stand together. Let's do a little bit of inventory. Okay. There was 3 points there to this entire thing. Money matters to God. Your identity is not based on your money. And God comes close to those willing to put him at the center. God makes his home wherever there is space at the center. When there's something else at the center, he's not going to make himself home there until that thing is knocked off. And guess what? He can't knock it off himself. Today, you receive communion elements on your way in. And here's what I know. And I know this. I mean, I know this as a fact. That when Jesus was getting ready to give his life, you and I were at the center. When Jesus was getting ready to pay it all, it was you, it was me who he was thinking about. He didn't have anything else. And the fact that we were at the center of his heart pushed him to go all the way for us, for all of us, for all of eternity. Perfect man, perfect God, crucified out of love for you and I. So what can I possibly put at the center of my life before him? I thank God that he had me at the center, that he persevered, because I couldn't have my identity or my life without him. Okay. So let's do a little bit of inventory. Would you close your eyes for just a second before we take these elements? And I want to ask you a set of questions. Okay. And this is just for you. This is not even for you and your spouse if you're married. This is just you. I mean, you know what I'm going to say. How have you kept God and money separate? Have you? Have you cared to think about what God thinks about your money? All your worries, all your planning, all your scheming, what does God have to say about it? Have you kept those two ideas completely separate from each other, thinking that God doesn't care or that there's greater wisdom in the world than there is in God's word? If you want to please God, you can't ignore his wisdom. So how have you kept God and money separate? Here's another question. How has money played a part in your identity? Do you feel like you're it because you have it? Or do you feel like you're nobody because you don't have any? Have you allowed your bank account, the money or lack thereof, sway how you feel about you or how you think God feels about you? Yeah, it's time to get rid of that. Your identity is not wrapped up in your dollars. Here's my last question. Are you willing to move your ideas of money over to allow God to be at the center? Are you willing? Are you willing to change, to flip the script, change the priorities? Let's pray together. Father, over the next few weeks, as we dive into your word and learn more and more about what you have to say, I pray, Father God, that we would decrease more and more and more, that our own ideas that we've based off of things that we learn from family or friends or from the world, God, that we push those things aside to learn what you think about money and how we can think like you about it. God, forgive us for the times that we put the ideas of money in the place where only you belong, at the very center of who we are, creating our identity, making us who we were truly meant to be, God. Forgive us for the times that we've put money in that place, when we've pursued money in a way thinking that we would be satisfied once we had it. God, forgive us for that vain pursuit. And help us, Lord God, to keep you at the center. Yeah. All right, now, we're going to take communion together. And communion reminds us of the love of God. It tells us a story of a perfect God who humbled himself. I mean, that's what's just so amazing. These little wafers, it's like this little tiny thing. I mean, you just, they're just like that, ever so gently, and it snaps. This God of the universe humbled himself, so meek and lowly, so gentle. His body was broken, his blood was shed for you, for me, because he loves you. He loves you. He loves you more than you can ever imagine. That's why he let his body be broken. Let's thank God for his body. Jesus, thank you for loving us so much, God, that you would humble yourself to the cross so that you might become our Lord. Let's eat the bread together. Thank you, Jesus. This tiny little cup represents the gallons upon gallons of blood that ran through Jesus' body that spilt as he was beaten and bruised, as he was cut open with whips. And this blood ran through the streets. This blood climbed up the hill of Golgotha to heal you and I, to free us from any bondage. Jesus, thank you for your blood. Thank you that you emptied yourself completely. Just like we're going to empty this cup right now, you emptied yourself. And so we thank you. Let's drink together. I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Sway. He's going to lead us in a song, just a reprisal of a song we sang earlier. In this moment, don't stop this moment right now. Stay in this moment of dedication to the Lord, of removing the idolatrous ways of money and replacing it with the worship of a holy God. Let's sing together. And I will not be
Trust would be in you, and that we wouldn't be shaken. Father, would you forgive me? I can only pray for me. Would you forgive me for the times that my trust was in anything but you? Would you forgive me for the times, oh God, that money, that other things stood in the place of the center of who I am, oh God? Father, forgive me and help me, O Lord, to start afresh in this new year, committing all that I am and all that I have to you, O God. I love you, Lord. We love you. It would be our desire, O God, to worship you and to serve you and you alone. Holy Spirit, we ask that the words, O God, that were taught today would go so deep into our hearts, that they would be like seeds, and as we leave here, that tonight and tomorrow and throughout the week, that they would begin to grow and develop and take the place, oh God, of thoughts that would be contrary to that, Lord. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see and a mind to perceive your great love for us, oh God. We love you, Jesus. And we commit our time to you today in Jesus' name. The church said, amen and amen. Center Church, I want to thank you so much for joining us today. As we said earlier, we have a lot of great things coming up this week. We have Immigrant Connection on Wednesday. We have youth group for 6th to 12th grade on Friday. We have all different things, and of course, Friday night prayer, and then we'll be back here next Sunday. But before you leave, just make sure that you connect with somebody one more time and let them know that you were happy to see them today. At Center Church, what do? We love God, we love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Amen? Bless you as you go.